If you're a regular viewer of this channel, then you will have seen me showing you graphs and data from Home Assistant's energy dashboard because I use it all the time. I use it to keep track of how much energy I'm importing and exporting from the grid, how much my batteries are using, and how much my solar panels generate. But in this video, I'm going to show you how I've taken this energy monitoring to another level, monitoring as many individual devices as I can in my home to get a detailed picture of where we're using energy. So check this out. This is a Sankey diagram showing the power flow in my home. A Sankey diagram is a really great way to visualize data flows, so it's perfect for illustrating where your power or energy is coming from and going to. Power or energy flows from left to right. You can see that my batteries are on the left, outputting power, and that flows to the right into the devices they are powering. I'll go into more detail later on about that dashboard card, so keep watching if you want to know how I created it. But first, I want to show you how I got all of that power data into Home Assistant in the first place, and that involves gadgets. The first thing I purchased was this smart energy monitoring plug from a company called Innr. This one here is monitoring the server rack in my garage. I chose this particular smart plug because it was reasonably priced, uses Zigbee, which means it doesn't add to the congestion on my Wi-Fi network, and it is a physically safe design for use in the UK. If you take a look at the back of the smart plug, you'll see that it has a recessed area. That makes it safer and easier to unplug because your fingers won't accidentally slide behind the plug and touch the pins. You'll notice that a lot of the cheap plugs available on Amazon sit flush with your socket, and that means that the manufacturers haven't put as much consideration into the safety aspects of their products. You'll also want to pay attention to the maximum current rating of any smart plugs you choose. The Innr plug is rated at 13 amps, which is the maximum current you should pull through a normal UK socket. You'll quite often see other smart plugs boasting 16 amp or even 20 amp ratings. Steer clear of these. If they've not paid attention to UK regulations, then what other quality controls are they ignoring? This is especially important if you are planning on using these on high powered devices like washing machines, where safety is a big concern. I've put these Innr plugs in a number of places. They're monitoring my server rack, I've got one on my dishwasher, and I've even hidden them behind the tumble dryer and the washing machine. I've had these smart plugs for a few months now and I'm finding them very reliable, but there were a few quirks when I set them up initially in Zigbee to MQTT. I had to make sure that I updated the firmware in order to get the live power output and also tweak a few other parameters on them. I'll put all of the details up on my website and a link in the description so as you can check that out if you need to. So that lets me monitor a number of big items around the house. I already had some other older smart plugs monitoring a heater in my wardrobe and my TV, and the EV charger has built-in power monitoring too. But what about super high powered appliances like my oven? I can't put that on a smart plug because it draws too much current. It would literally melt a smart plug. And then there's my lights. There are loads of them and I'd have to find lots of special smart bulbs with power monitoring or something, which would be impractical. Well, I have a Shelly Pro EM that I installed outside to monitor my heat pump and immersion heater. It connects to Wi-Fi and has been extremely reliable so far, using CT clamps around the live wires to monitor current flow. So I had a look at the other Shelly products available and came across the Shelly Pro 3 EM. This is actually designed to monitor three-phase power supplies, but it can be configured to monitor three uniphase supplies instead. This is perfect for monitoring my two light circuits, upstairs and downstairs, and also my oven. My very friendly local electrician installed the Shelly Pro 3EM in my main consumer unit, putting the CT clamps around the live cables for each of those three circuits. It's designed to be DIN rail mounted and sits very neatly in the consumer unit, and you can either connect it to your network using an Ethernet cable or Wi-Fi. The CT clamps are quite bulky, so it was a bit of a squeeze getting the cover back on afterwards. But the end result was Home Assistant automatically detecting the Shelly and presenting me with entities monitoring the power and energy of all three circuits. As much as I try and steer away from Wi-Fi devices when I can, Shelly are probably the easiest smart devices to set up that I've ever had. So I've now got a huge chunk of my home's devices on power monitors, and as a consequence, I can have a dashboard like this. Apart from the home demand meter, all of the others are power meters of some kind. The home demand one is a specially calculated virtual sensor, which figures out how much power I'm using in the home total based on the differences between import, export, solar generation and battery usage. The power meters are pretty reactive. In fact, hold on one second, I'll go and turn the oven on. Right, see? Responsive. So that's live power use in the home, which is great to sit and watch, but it's far more useful to see your energy consumption over specific periods of time. And that's where Home Assistant's energy dashboard comes in. On the energy dashboard's configuration page, if you scroll down, you can add individual devices. You can see here that I've added in all of the energy sensors I have for the various devices around my home. You can give each one a label in case their default names aren't suitable for the energy dashboard. For example, my TV's entity name is TV Power Energy, but I want it to just show up as TV on the energy dashboard. Notice that I have a single item for lighting rather than separate ones for upstairs and downstairs. I decided I didn't want them separated on the dashboard, so I created a group helper, and in the configuration of the group I chose both the upstairs and downstairs light energy sensors and set up the group type to sum. I could then use that new group sensor in the energy dashboard instead. Now when I look at the energy dashboard, I can scroll all the way to the bottom and see two new individual devices graphs. The top graph shows your device's energy use over time, and if you hover over the various sections of the bars, it'll tell you how much energy it used for that particular time period. You can even click on device names to hide them from the graph temporarily. Underneath the detailed usage graph is the total usage for that time period. It's ordered from most to least usage, and hovering over each bar gives you a useful pop-up with the actual value. What makes this dashboard very useful is that you can select the time period for the data you wish to see. For example, you can see how much energy your device has used over the last month, or any custom time period you select. I'd better talk about the Sankey diagram now, because I did promise. I created the chart using the Sankey chart card integration available in Hacks. It's quite a complicated card to configure, I'll be honest, but I think the end result is worth it. Your configuration will be very different to my configuration, or indeed anyone else's, because it really depends on what devices you have, whether you have solar or batteries and that sort of thing. The most important thing to remember though is that it flows left to right, so your grid monitoring will need to be split into separate import and export sensors. Your import will be on the left and your export on the right. The same with your batteries, battery output or discharging on the left, battery input or charging on the right. At the time of writing, there is a GUI to do some basic configuration, but the reality is you still need to edit YAML to get it working properly. You need to tell the card which entities are children of other entities so as it knows where power is flowing. If you want to show energy, then in theory the card can automatically configure itself using your energy dashboard configuration, but I found it a little bit hit and miss. I also much prefer to use the card for displaying live power flows. Because it's tricky to show you live how the card looks in various situations, I've taken some screenshots over the last couple of weeks instead. This is how my home looks most of the time. Power is flowing from my two batteries via the demand section and into the monitored devices. If I turn my heat pump on, then that increases the demand. When the batteries start to run out, I have to import from the grid, and you can see the red flow coming in from the grid on the left here. But on sunny days, I get solar generation. This screenshot shows my solar generation meeting my home demand, and the excess solar is going into my battery, charging it up for use later. You can see the battery charging in green on the right of the diagram. And finally, once the batteries are full, the solar meets my home's demands and exports the excess straight to the grid, which is the red flow on the right-hand side. I will of course put the YAML configuration for my card up on my website for you to reference, and there's a link down in the description for that. But please keep in mind that this is just an example. You can use it as a starting point for your own card, but you'll need to add or remove devices if you don't have batteries, for example, and you'll need to replace all of the entities with your own ones. You may also have noticed this other section in grey. This is basically all of the rest of the unmonitored devices in my house, so it's things like my alarm, my computer, my children's computers, the microwave, and various other things wasting energy on standby. I will probably buy a few more smart plugs plugs at some point to try and reduce that other value and get even more detail on where we're using power. But for now, I think I have the majority of things covered. And don't forget that you can also add up to 4 of these monitor devices into the PowerFlow Card Plus if you use that too, which is a great compact at-a-glance card to show your home's power flows. Anyway, I hope you found this useful. Links to products and configuration is in the description in case you need it. And a massive thank you to my amazing channel members and patrons for supporting my channel. If you'd like to support the channel too, then check out the links on joining down in the description. In return, I'll give you early access to my videos and some bonus content too. Please give this video a like and subscribe to my channel for free to see more from me. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.